Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Vampire Knitting Club by Nancy Warren, narrated by Sarah Zimmerman. Chapter 1. Cardinal Woolsey's knitting shop has appeared on postcards celebrating the quaint views of Oxford, of which there are many. When a visitor has tired of writing, "Wish you were here," on the back of pictures of the various colleges, the dreaming spires, and the dome of the Radcliffe Camera, a cozy little shop, painted blue, brimming with baskets of wool and hand-knitted goods, can be so much more inviting. My grandmother, Agnes Bartlett, owned the best knitting shop in Oxford, and I was on my way to visit her after spending a very hot month at a dig site in Egypt with my archaeologist parents. I was looking forward to telling Gran about my latest life crisis. I might be 27 years old and supposedly all grown up, but Gran was always ready to wrap her warm arms around me and tell me everything was going to be all right. I needed comforting after discovering my boyfriend of 2 years, Todd, had stuck his salami in someone else's sandwich. I referred to him now as my ex-boyfriend, the Toad. I was thinking how much I needed Gran's wisdom, her hugs, and her homemade ginger snaps as I walked down Corn Market Street toward Ship Street. A busker played his guitar and sang Bob Dylan, not very successfully, as suggested by the small number of coins in his open guitar case. I dodged out of the way before a tour group swallowed me whole. As I passed, the tour guide was pointing out the 3-story timber-framed building on the corner, where it leaned drunkenly into the street. Built in 1386 for a local wine merchant, this was originally called the New Inn. It's one of Oxford's few remaining medieval domestic buildings. I moved past them and couldn't hear any more. I'd learned a lot about Oxford from overhearing snatches of tours. One day I should really take one. Just past Ship Street, I turned into Harrington Street, where Gran's yarn shop was located. After the bustle and crowds of Corn Market, it seemed quiet and nearly deserted. My case bounced and rattled as I crossed the patch of cobblestones in front of Cardinal College. The college was named for Cardinal Woolsey, Henry VIII's right-hand man, until he couldn't manage to get the king out of his first marriage when he promptly fell out of favor. Since the knitting shop was down the street from the college, my great-grandmother had called her shop Cardinal Woolsey's. A sign outside the arched entrance informed me that the college was closed to visitors today. It wasn't the main entrance, but it still featured fierce gargoyles glaring down over the pale gold Headington stone facade, and through the gate I glimpsed the quad, with a fountain in its center. I continued, following the college wall to its end, passing a row of parked bicycles, and then to the commercial part of Harrington where the shops were. They weren't as old as the colleges. They were Georgian, mostly, standing like a row of elegant ladies, in cream or the palest pastel shades. They contained shops at street level and flats above. Cardinal Woolsey's was in the middle of the row, with a pale green plaster front and original sash windows, all painted white. The shop had one big front window and a door with a glass panel. All the woodwork was painted bright blue. The front window displayed richly colored wools, an antique spinning wheel draped with a crocheted blanket that looked perfect for snuggling up in. There was a selection of books, kits, and a gorgeous red sweater that made a person wish they knew how to knit. Suddenly, I started to feel as though cold, wet fingers were walking down the back of my neck. The September day was mild, and I was warm since I'd walked from the train station. Every part of me was warm but the back of my neck. When I looked ahead, I saw 2 ladies on the other side of the street headed toward me. One of them was Gran. She wore a black skirt, sensible shoes, and one of her hand-knitted cardigans, this one in orange and blue. With her was a glamorous woman in her 60s whom I didn't recognize. I called out and waved. They both wore wide-brimmed hats, and as I started forward, they ducked their chins so their faces were hidden from me. Still, I'd know my grandmother anywhere. I called again, "Gran!" moving faster so my suitcase began to bounce. I was sure they saw me, but as I sped toward them, They veered down Rook Lane, a narrow passageway that connects Harrington to George Street. What on earth? I lifted my case and began to run, though my case was so heavy it was more of a grunting stagger. "Gran!" I yelled again. I ran to the bottom of the alley they'd turned into, but it was deserted. A dry, shriveled leaf tumbled across the flagstones, and from a window ledge a small black cat regarded me with what looked like pity. Otherwise, Rook Lane was empty. "Agnes Bartlett!" I yelled at the top of my lungs. I stood, panting. The lane was lined with ancient, half-timbered Tudor houses mixed with Victorian cottages. She was visiting in one of those homes, presumably. I wondered if it belonged to her glamorous friend. I followed them down the flagstoned alley. A black wooden door set into the wall beneath a Gothic arch was just shutting as I reached it. I contemplated ringing the small brass bell, but didn't want to make a fool of myself, so resisted and walked on. Well, there was no point hanging around in a deserted lane. I'd go to Cardinal Woolsey's and wait for Gran there. Her assistant, Rosemary, would be working, and I could let myself into the upstairs flat and unpack while I waited for my grandmother to return. I couldn't wait to tell Gran the news about my broken heart, knowing I'd get more sympathy and understanding than I got from Mom, who, even when she looked at me, still seemed to be thinking of times and people long gone. I'd always found it difficult to compete with the mysteries of the ancient world, but Gran listened with her whole attention and always said exactly the right thing. I think the only disappointment for both of us was that she'd never been able to teach me to knit. Everything I tried, whether it was a sweater, a pair of socks, or a simple scarf, ended up looking like a scrunched-up hedgehog. I got to the entrance of the quaint, blue-fronted shop and tried the door. It didn't open. I tried again, pushing harder before my other senses kicked in, and I realized there were no lights on inside. A printed page was taped to the windowed front door that said, "Cardinal Woolsey's is closed until further notice." At the bottom was a phone number. Closed until further notice. I pressed my face against the window in the door, but everything was dark. Where was Rosemary? Gran never closed the shop outside of her posted closing days. And why was there a fan of mail on the floor? It looked as if no one had picked it up in weeks. When I straightened and looked down the street again, a teenaged girl walked by and stared at me through narrowed eyes. She looked like a goth, with a pale face, dark, heavily made-up eyes, and long black hair. Her outfit was also all black, including the umbrella shielding her. It was a dry day with no hint of rain. Perhaps she was one of those people who always liked to be prepared. No doubt she had snow boots in the tapestry bag she carried, and sunscreen in case the sun should decide to shine. I turned back to the shop and wondered what to do. There wasn't much communication at the dig site, and I hadn't thought to check ahead and make sure Gran had remembered I was coming. She always remembered. I stood there gnawing my lip. I stepped back almost into the road and looked up, but I couldn't see lights on in the flat either. The proper entrance to the flat is off the lane behind the shop, so dragging my case behind me once more, I continued on past penny farthing antiques. I noted the still life oil painting of the bowl of fruit and the dead fish was still displayed, as it had been when I was last here 6 months ago, along with a bow front chest supporting a silver tea set. I dragged my bag toward the pub on the corner of New Inn Hall Street, the Bishop's Mitre. The date 1588 was carved into the wooden lintel of the pub, which served ale to King Charles II when he was in hiding during the English Civil War. It called itself a gastro pub now. Across from me was St. John's Church with its ancient graveyard. I rounded the corner, walked past the side of the pub, and turned down the lane that ran behind the row of shops. The lane was barely wide enough for one car and featured plenty of no parking signs. When I got to Gran's place, her tiny ancient car was sitting in the equally tiny parking spot she managed to wedge the vehicle into. I opened the wooden gate and walked up the path through the small back garden. Gran grew wildflowers and herbs mostly, but the beds looked overgrown and in need of water. As I walked down the narrow, winding path to her door, my leg brushed against lavender that had bushed out into the path. I stopped for a moment, enjoying the scents of rosemary and lavender, thyme and roses, and the sounds of fat, happy bees who didn't seem to mind that the garden was a mess. When I got to the door, I pressed the intercom, just in case someone was there. No one answered. I tried a second time, holding my finger on the button that would ring upstairs, but there was still nothing. I pulled out my phone, but I don't know why I bothered. I didn't have a UK plan yet. I left my suitcase tucked against the door and walked back around to Harrington Street and past the yarn shop. Next door was Elderflower Tea Shop. The two Miss Watts, who owned the tea shop, had been pouring tea and baking scones and other English delicacies for decades, possibly centuries. They knew everyone and everything about the neighborhood. Also, they were both close friends of my grandmother. If she was out visiting, I could wait for her here. As I walked into the warm and familiar tea shop, the elder Miss Watts, Mary, glanced up at me. Her face had that, "Yes, can I help you?" expression, which quickly changed to sorrow when she recognized me. "Oh, Lucy, is that you?" "Yes, how are you, Miss Watt?" "I'm fine, dear." She didn't look fine, though. She looked worried, verging on panicked. She glanced around as though she could summon help, but other than herself, there was no one in the shop but me and a family of French tourists. "Gran's not home. I thought I'd wait for her here." She put her hands over her mouth and then stepped around from behind the counter and ushered me to a table, as far from her only other customers as she could get. "Then you haven't heard. Sit down, dear. Let me get you some tea." The mild unease I'd felt deepened. "Heard what? What's going on?" She shook her head slowly. When her eyes filled with tears, I felt my stomach clench in dread. The hard wood of the seat bumped against my butt as I sat without realizing I was going to. As rump bumped wood, she said, "I'm so sorry, Lucy. Your grandmother passed away." "No," I whispered the word. "That's impossible. I just saw her on the street." Sadness was coming off her in waves. She shook her head. "You must have seen someone who looked like her." I'd been so certain it was Gran. Could I have been mistaken? I recalled the moment when I'd seen her. She hadn't acknowledged me, even though I'd shouted her name and waved. The woman had been wearing a hat, which Gran never did, but she looked so much like Gran. "Are you sure?" She nodded. Life without Gran was unthinkable. Of course, I'd known she was old and would die sometime, but she was a robust woman in her early 80s, showing no signs of slowing down, often boasting that she'd never known a day's illness. "It was very peaceful," Mary Watt said. "She died in her sleep, and she wasn't a young woman. But she wasn't old, not really, and she was always so healthy. Maybe if I hadn't seen that woman who was a dead ringer for Gran, I wouldn't be having so much trouble accepting she was gone. It's how we all want to go, isn't it? Healthy to the last, and then one day to go to bed and not wake up." Mary Watt was very close in age to my Gran. She wasn't only making polite conversation, she really wanted to go that way. I sat there, staring at the oak tabletop. I didn't hear Miss Watt move, and I was in the same position when she reappeared with a brown Betty pot of tea, two cups, and one of their famous scones served with jam and clotted cream. She poured me a cup and then sat down and poured herself the second cup. "Drink your tea, dear, and try the scone. You're probably hungry." I couldn't eat. Because it gave me something to do, I picked up the cup and drank some tea. The brew was strong and hot, and I sipped for a few minutes as I absorbed the terrible news. Miss Watt kept her wide-eyed gaze on me. Her gray hair was coiled in a tidy bun at the back of her neck, as always. Her face was kind and sad. Her faded blue eyes regarded me with sympathy. "I don't know what to do," I said at last. There was a phone number on the notice stuck to Gran's store, but my phone doesn't work here. She nodded sympathetically, then jumped to her feet as though pleased to be able to offer concrete help. "You can use our phone. That number belongs to her solicitor, I think." "Does it?" I was having trouble concentrating. It felt like she was talking to me from a long way away. "I imagine so.
Anyway, you must stay with me and Florence while you sort things out. We have a nice cozy guest room upstairs. As much as I appreciated the kindness of the two sisters, I knew that I needed to be in Gran's home while I digested the news. Thank you. That's really nice of you. But if I could use your phone, I'll call the lawyer and see if I can get the keys today. Well, of course you can call from here. But we've got the keys to your grandmother's shop and the flat upstairs. We always kept each other's keys, you know. She patted my hand, then went behind the cash desk, and returned with a set of keys on a round brass ring. It wasn't until I was leaving that I turned to her and asked the question I should have asked much earlier. When did Gran die? About 3 weeks ago. No one could get hold of you or your mother. I'm so sorry. When I let myself into Gran's knitting shop, the first thing I noticed was that familiar scent. Cardinal Woolsey smelled like wool and old stone. And if gossip had a scent, I could smell all the secrets that had been shared over knitting patterns and classes. Everyone had loved my grandmother. Friends and customers brought their problems to her and their stories. She gave good advice, but most of all, she was an excellent listener. Simply talking to her made you feel better. I gazed at the baskets of wool stacked on the shelves, and at the knitting porn, those gorgeous pattern books and magazines featuring beautiful women, complicated sweaters, and shawls I'm sure no human could knit, certainly not me. As I looked around, I felt such a sense of nostalgia and sadness that I had to hang on to the counter to steady myself. The silence felt as heavy as my grief. I picked up the small stack of mail that had collected, placed it on the wooden counter, then I let myself through the door that connected to the flat upstairs, flipping on lights as I went. The upstairs flat was on two floors. On the main was an old-fashioned kitchen, a sitting room, dining room, and a study cum TV room. Above that were two bedrooms and bathroom. It smelled musty, like an old house that's been shut up during the summer. I opened windows, then went back down the back stairs, retrieved my suitcase, and hauled it up the steps to the second bedroom, which I always thought of as mine. Gran had let me decorate the room when I was a teenager, and I still liked the lilac walls and the purple flowered bedding. On the wall was a poster of Miley Cyrus and her pre-twerking days, and another of the Spice Girls. My eyes filled with tears when I saw that the bed was all made up and ready for me. There were fresh towels on the bed. Gran had been looking forward to my arrival. I walked back downstairs to the kitchen. I wasn't hungry, but I needed something to occupy me. I opened the fridge and the cupboards randomly. Someone had tossed the perishable food items, but there were her favorite biscuits and a half jar of the marmalade she always used. I had to really gather my courage to walk into her bedroom. Strangely, though she had died there, I had the least sense of her in that room. The bedding had been stripped down to the mattress, and the room seemed oddly impersonal. Why couldn't she have waited? If she was going to die, I should have been here. I busied myself with unpacking, and then walked to the convenience store on the corner, the full stop. There I stocked up on milk, eggs, a loaf of bread, and some fruit. When I got home, I made myself some toast and sat thinking, remembering, mostly, until the church bells chimed 10 o'clock and I decided to go to bed. I don't know if it was jet lag or grief, but I found myself wide awake at 2 a.m. The kind of wide awake where you know there's no point banging your head against the pillow because you won't be falling asleep again. I got out of bed and realized I needed to do something. I was full of restless energy. I wanted to cry and scream and break things. Instead, I dressed in jeans and an old sweater, shoved my feet into sneakers, and went downstairs to the shop. I flipped on the lights and then walked around almost mindlessly, tidying and straightening. One of the charms of Cardinal Woolsey's was that it never changed. I knew exactly where everything should be because it had always been there. However, as I tidied up, I realized that the basket of Fair Isle knitting wool had somehow shifted to the area where mohair should be. I swapped the baskets back to the correct places. Gran was always meticulous about keeping her shop clean as well as tidy, so I grabbed a duster and went to work. When I finished the dusting, I pulled out the vacuum cleaner and got to work on the old wooden plank floor. I was pushing the wand into a corner when I caught the gleam of gold. I dropped to my knees and reached under the bottom shelf and discovered Gran's eyeglasses. She'd always kept them on a gold chain around her neck, but the chain was broken. I held them in my hands, feeling a shudder of sadness go through me, and something else. The chain ran through my fingers again and again, as though in a dream. I had the feeling of fear and something terrible chasing me, but no sense of what the thing was. My heart was pounding when my vision cleared. I searched the area and noticed a line of black splatters on the old hardwood floor. Could be paint, could be nail polish, but as the daughter of two archaeologists, I knew the importance of investigating small details. I dampened a tissue and rubbed carefully at the largest spot. A rusty brown came up on the tissue. I'm not much of an expert in forensics, but I was fairly certain it was blood. Here's the thing. My grandmother was close to blind without her glasses on, especially at night, so I had to ask myself, if she had died peacefully in her bed, as Miss Watt had told me, then why were her broken glasses downstairs in the shop, along with recently spilled blood? Chapter 2. I was crouched down, staring at the lenses of my grandmother's glasses, my mind working furiously, when I felt a cold draft. The back of my neck prickled and I shivered. Gran would have said someone had just walked over my grave. It wasn't a noise that made me glance up, not even a movement. It felt more like a presence, the kind that would make me sometimes flip on a light when I woke in the night from one of my dreams, heart pounding as it was beginning to pound now. Of course, when I switched my light on at home, it was always to the reassuring sight of my own bedroom, with no monsters, serial killers, or otherwise scary dudes in my space. This time, I wasn't so lucky. There was a man standing inside the door. I must have made a sound, though I'd have sworn I was too frightened even to breathe. He turned quickly, and I felt he was as startled to see me as I was to see him. But seen me, he undoubtedly had, so I rose to my feet, trying to beat back the panic. "Who are you?" I asked. I wanted to sound tough and controlled, but even I could hear my voice waver. "Where's Agnes?" he retorted. "Agnes?" I was surprised she'd know a man like this. "Yes," he sounded impatient and took a step forward. "Agnes Bartlett." I wasn't about to tell him that my grandmother was dead, not when he'd appeared out of nowhere in the middle of the night, so I asked again, "Who are you?" He stepped forward. He was tall, lean, and elegant, about 35 or so. He wore black slacks and a dark gray sweater, but the way he wore it, the outfit could have been a tuxedo. His hair was black, his eyes dark, and his face pale. He fascinated and repelled me at once. "My name is Rafe Crozier." I followed up with a second, more important question. "How did you get in?" He hesitated. "I saw the light. I was passing and thought Agnes might need something." If he knew my grandmother, how did he not know she'd passed away? And why was he strolling past in the middle of the night? "Do you live in the neighborhood?" He glanced behind me as though I might have my grandmother hidden somewhere. "Yes, but I've been out of town. Is she here?" I licked dry lips. "Maybe you should come back tomorrow." His brow creased. "You're holding her glasses, and the chain appears to be broken." The chain made a noise as my hand shook as much from grief as from fear. I wondered if I was in the middle of some elaborate dream. Maybe Gran wasn't dead, and I wasn't having a bizarre conversation with a strange man in the middle of the night, holding my grandmother's broken glasses. "Do you often visit her in the middle of the night?" A flicker of something crossed his face. Irritation? Amusement? "I suffer from insomnia. Your grandmother is also a sufferer." He smiled slightly at my obvious shock that he'd referred to her as my grandmother. "Lucy, I presume. Your grandmother often speaks of you. I've seen your photograph." Maybe she'd spoken of me to him, but I was positive my grandmother had never mentioned tall, dark, and snooty. I'd have remembered. Still, if he knew her so well, I was tempted to tell him what had happened. But I'd spent too much time in chaotic cities, warned by my parents never to talk to strangers, to unburden myself. Not at 3 a.m. when I was all alone. He'd been watching me fiddle with the broken chain.
Your grandmother can't see 2 feet in front of her without those glasses.
He took a step back and deliberately relaxed his pose.
I only want to know that she's all right.
Please, I said, come back tomorrow. He hesitated.
I'll be in meetings all day. I'll come tomorrow evening after sunset.
Whatever. He smiled at that.
Until tomorrow evening, then?
He reached into his pocket and I flinched, thinking of all the things a scary guy could pull out of his pocket, but his hand emerged holding nothing more lethal than a business card.
If you need anything, call me at this number, day or night.
I reached for the card as he passed it forward, and our hands brushed. Your hands are so cold, I said. It's a bit of a problem I have when I'm nervous. I blab whatever I'm thinking. He drew back and flexed his fingers.
Poor circulation.
He walked back to the door.
Good night.
Wait, how did you get in? He still hadn't explained how he'd appeared inside the shop. He paused.
The door was unlocked.
I'm not sure of a lot of things in life, like what a guy means when he says, I'll call you, or whether my hair looks better long or short, but I was damned sure I'd lock that door before I went up to bed. Damned sure. After the scary guy left, I made triple sure that the outer door was locked and the one that led to the flat, and then I went back upstairs. I carried Gran's broken glasses with me, wishing they could talk. Something wasn't right. Why were her glasses broken and in the shop if she died peacefully in her bed? And since when was she pally with a strange man who walked into the shop in the wee hours without so much as knocking? Rafe Crozier was seriously hot. I'd have suspected her late-night caller had more than knitting in mind, but as far as I knew, she'd never had another man after my grandfather died. Plus, the age difference must be about 50 years, and he did not seem the toy boy type. I went back to bed, but I was so unnerved. I got up and turned on the bathroom light, leaving my bedroom door open so I wouldn't be shut up in the dark. My room no longer felt like a safe, comfortable refuge. Every noise, whether inside or out, had me opening my eyes wide to search out any possible danger until exhaustion finally claimed me, and I slept. When I woke, the sun was shining, and I looked out my window to the skyline that could be nowhere but Oxford. They may call the gathering of church steeples dreaming spires, but they'd interrupted my dreams throughout the night, chiming the hour. It always took me a couple of nights to get used to bells ringing every hour on the hour all night long. I glanced at my phone and found it was after 11. I felt thick and stupid and desperate for that first cup of coffee, but at least I'd slept. I stumbled to the kitchen, put on coffee, and while it brewed, so did my thoughts. Gran's glasses, blood on the floor, the strange visitor last night. Put those things together, and I came to any number of disturbing possibilities, none of which made any sense. What I needed, and badly, was information. The first thing I had to do was to phone the number on the sign on the door. I'd been too stunned to do it yesterday. Gran had never owned a mobile phone that I knew of. She had actual wall phones, one in the store and one in her apartment above. I'd snapped a photo of the sign on the door, and as soon as I'd drunk my first cup of strong coffee, I sucked in a breath and called the number.
Mills, Tate, and Elliot, how may I direct your call? A pleasant female voice inquired.
I found this number on a sign taped to Cardinal Woolsey's, the knitting shop on Harrington Street. The owner was my grandmother.
Please hold, she said, and the line clicked.
In a few seconds, an older male voice said,
George Tate speaking.
Once more, I explained about the note and the number.
And what is your name?
He asked. Lucy Agnes Swift. Yes, Agnes, for my grandmother.
Miss Swift, I'm very sorry to inform you that your grandmother passed away several weeks ago. I'd very much like to speak to you. When would it be convenient to come to our offices?
Fortunately, my grandmother had employed an Oxford firm of lawyers within walking distance of the shop, so we agreed that I would stop by at 2 that afternoon.
And please bring official identification with you, he said before ringing off.
I took a shower in the old-fashioned bathroom, climbing into the big tub and banging my shin as I did every single time I returned to Gran's place. It always took me a few bruises to get the bath-climbing routine down. I showered, left my long blonde hair to dry on its own, brushed my teeth, put on mascara and lipstick, and dressed in my best jeans and a long-sleeved cotton t-shirt. When I'd flown out of Cairo, the temperature had been sweltering. Here it was approaching sweater weather. Somehow I needed to get hold of my mother and let her know that Gran was gone, but I decided to see the lawyer first and find out as much as I could. According to Miss Watt and the lawyer, my grandmother had died weeks ago. I must have missed her funeral. Somehow, missing the burial made everything more painful. I hadn't had a chance to say goodbye. I would have to find out where she was buried and at least take some flowers. I needed closure. I glanced at the glasses on their broken chain, which I seemed to keep carrying around with me, as though Gran might suddenly appear and ask for them. I needed more than a gravesite to visit. I needed answers. I'd placed the business card the strange man had given me last night on the kitchen counter, and I picked it up now. The cardstock was plain but expensive. Rafe William Crozier, and a phone number, mobile phone, email address, and a website. According to his card, he was an antiquarian book and restoration expert. I would definitely be checking out his website before I saw him again. I'm good like that, checking up on strange men who walk in on me in the middle of the night. The offices of Mills, Tate, and Elliot occupied a Victorian brick storefront on New Inn Hall Street, only 5 minutes walk away. I opened the old oak door and expected to find a clerk writing with a quill pen, but to my relief, the inside of the law office was quite modern. The receptionist might sit behind a counter older than some countries, but she punched my details into a slick computer and then asked me to take a seat. I'd barely picked up a copy of The Economist when a thin, elegant man in his 60s, wearing a navy blue suit, stepped toward me. "Miss Swift?" "Yes." I rose and shook his hand, and he led me to an office that looked like a professor's lair. It was lined with books, and the heavy, ornate desk was covered in paper. There was no computer in this office, only a phone. I could see why my grandmother had hired him. I sat on one side of the desk, and Mr. Tate sat on the other. He stared at me so long I had to force myself not to fidget.
"Did you bring your identification?"
"Yes." I tugged both my passports from my bag. I'm a dual citizen, having been born in Oxford to my British mother and American father, and having lived most of my life in the States. My father was an American lecturer in Oxford when he met my mother, who was a student there. They moved to Massachusetts when I was still a baby, but worked on dig sites all over the world. I'd spent most of my summers with my grandmother in Oxford, and they'd been some of my happiest times.
"Excellent. I'll have these copied."
He poked his head out the door, and the woman at the front fetched them. Then he sat back, shook his head, and sighed.
"Well, my dear, I'm sorry for your loss. Your grandmother was a wonderful woman."
"She was. Did you know her well?"
"We met now and again, socially. We were both friends of the Bodleian Library. My firm did all her legal work, what there was of it."
"Of course." He pulled a file forward and opened it.
"Are you at all familiar with your grandmother's will?"
"No, not at all."
"She never discussed it with you?"
I shook my head. Why would she discuss her will with me? My mother must be her heir. She only had the one child.
"Agnes did not leave her estate to her daughter. She left everything to you. She also left you a letter."
He withdrew a sheaf of papers from the file and a sealed envelope that he pushed across the desktop toward me. I recognized the loopy handwriting and felt a great sweep of sadness. I picked up the envelope, knowing I wouldn't read it in the lawyer's presence. I'd wait until I was alone. He resettled his gold-rimmed glasses over his nose and scanned pages as though he were reminding himself of the contents. Then he began.
"Your grandmother's estate consists of the shop and the living quarters above it. In that part of town, the property is worth quite a pretty sum. Other than that, she has some savings, and, of course, the income from Cardinal Woolsey's. All this is to go to you."
"But what about my mother?" I was already struggling to accept my grandmother's death, to think of inheriting her property.
Well, I didn't have room in my brain for more sharks. I imagine your grandmother's reasoning will be explained in that letter. I was certain my mother would not grudge me the shop. She and my father were much too busy with their research to be bothered with it, but I'd never considered that I might one day be asked to run a knitting shop. I was 27 years old, and not at all sure what I wanted to do with my life. I was at a crossroads. I'd worked for a couple of years in administration for a pharmaceutical firm, sitting in a cubicle for 8 hours a day. The atmosphere was so dull, the cactus I brought into work died. I was certain it died of boredom. My entire department was made redundant, which was good, as it meant I didn't have to sit in that cubicle anymore, and bad, as I had no income. I was still reeling from that shock when, a few days later, on a Friday evening, Todd Pocket dialed me. I answered, but instead of hearing him speak to me, I heard him panting and muttering something over and over again that sounded like, "Oh yeah, baby." Todd had told me he was playing poker with the boys. It didn't sound like poker was the game going on, so I got into my car and drove the short distance to his basement suite, where I discovered Todd and a girl he worked with going at it on the kitchen table. I've often thought since that if Todd had taken off his jeans all the way, we might still be going out. This trip had been partly a way to get over the humiliation of Todd's betrayal, as well as an opportunity to figure out what I really wanted to do with my life. I had no idea what a tidy sum might mean, but I was hopeful that if I sold the shop, I might have enough to live on for a while.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.